someone and say, it will require more than 1 year, but then every year you are having to send these things out in thousands, 100,000, 200,000 every year. And that went on and on until. So while Moab was working so hard, Israel was becoming richer while they were becoming poorer. And yet they are the ones producing. And so the Bible says when the king of Israel died, Ahab, his son Jehoram took over from him and then expected that this thing should continue. The tribute that Moab paid to his father, to the country of Israel, should continue. And then the king of Moab looked at this thing and said, look, we can't go on like this. Because if we continue like this, we are going to become a useless country. We won't be able to have anything left for the subsequent generations. So the king of Moab sent a word to the king of Israel, the new king of Israel, and said, sir, we congratulate you for your emergence as king in place of your father. But we are sorry to let you know that thing we used to do with your father, we will no longer be doing it. I pray for you today. What used to happen before, at the end of today's encounter, it will cease to happen. That amen is not godly at all. Whatever used to happen in your family that is not good, that is affecting you negatively, after today's encounter, that thing will come to an end. If the person I'm prophesying to is here, let me hear your loudest amen. They said, we will no longer pay that tribute. The king of Israel took offense. They said, God punish you. You can't dare. You won't dare. I'll teach you a lesson you will never forget. I want you to understand something. One of the things you need to know about the enemy is that it does not need to have a good reason to launch an assault against anyone. The enemy, for the flimsiest reason, or for no reason at all, can come up against someone, and you'll be wondering, what did I do to warrant all of this? Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible says the king of Israel began to threaten fire and brimstone, and didn't just end with threats. He began to mobilize his army. He mobilized his army, and that was not enough for him. He needed support. Oh my God. It's like Togo now paying tribute to America every year. And then the president of Togo woke up one morning and decided, look, we will not do this thing again. We want what we want to be enough only for Togo and not for other people. We want to eat the sweat of our own faces. We want to eat what we labor for, the fruit of our own labor. We do not want somebody else to continue to eat it while we languish in penury and hardship. Ladies and gentlemen, then the president of America became angry. I want you to check in your mind. Does America need any support to fight Togo? Come to me, church. America needs to fight Togo and is looking for support. No, sir. Without prayers, without any special preparation, they can eliminate the very existence of Togo, right? Now, America didn't just go up against Togo. The Bible says the king of Israel sent a message to Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and said, the king of Moab has rebelled against me. I want to go and fight him. Will you go with me? The king of Judah said, your people are like my people. We are brothers. We are family. So your battle is my battle. I am with you. That's America now sending message to the British prime minister and saying, look, Togo has offended us. We want to go and fight Togo. Will you go with us? Britain say, we are with you. Just tell us the number of soldiers you need. And you have it. That was not enough. The Bible says they fetched a compass through Edom. You know the Edomites are the descendants of Esau, right? Esau and Jacob, Israel, are twin brothers. The king of Edom, also said, I'm going with you. So America and Britain teamed up. It was not enough for them. They sent word to Russia. Say, please, we want to go and fight Togo. Will you go? How many of you know that Russian Putin? Both his laughter and his anger, the facial expression is the same. I wish I could pull out somebody and help you get this picture. Father, come. Just come. I want to explain something. Come, sir. Come. Very good.
Forces are too strong for you to handle.
So he looked up, looked down, left, right, center. There's nobody he can run to. So out of frustration, the Bible says, he called on a God he too did not know. Because this man is not a Christian. He's not a child of God. He does not go to church. He does not worship God. Moab is an outcast nation. Are you understanding what I'm saying? And yet the Bible says, how do I drag this God into this matter? He took his eldest son, the one that should have been king after him. He looked at him. You can imagine how heartbroken this man would be. Son, you know I love you. You know when you are about to take some drastic decisions, you first of all create a preamble around it to try to establish certain truths. Say, son, you know I love you. The son says, yes, Daddy, I know you love me. So why do you have to remind me of that? He says, you know I love you, but, son, it is better that one man should die than the whole country be swept off. Because if the entire nation is wiped out, you are supposed to be king after me. There won't be any country to preside over. So, son, I love you, but I'm sorry you have to go at this point. This man did not have an altar to make sacrifices to. If it was to his idol, this man has idols that he could have taken the son to go and sacrifice in his shrine. No, I have heard preachers preach and say that he offered it to his God. No, sir, that was not it. The Bible says he pushed the son to a wall, a dwarf wall, one of the walls that had collapsed, whatever was left of it. No altar to sacrifice on. The Bible says he took his knife, slit the throat of this boy, blood gushed out, and offered him as a burnt sacrifice to a God he did not know. Ladies and gentlemen, God saw the action of this man out of frustration. The Bible says his anger broke out against Israel, Jehoshaphat, Judah, and Edom. God angry with somebody is the devil going on rampage against you. Do you understand what I'm saying? Look at the picture in my mind. It's very, very interesting. It's like this. Understand that before these people came to fight this man, the Bible said they offered the morning sacrifice. How many of you remember that? If you read the passage from the beginning, they offered the morning sacrifice. It was after the morning sacrifice, Elisha began to prophesy. So these people didn't just go to battle. They brought a sacrifice to consult God for the next phase of this encounter. Now, while they started destroying this man is retreating. Then he carries his son. Please, this is Nigeria. Interpret it as Ghana must go. If you want. He dragged Ghana must go. Ran, came behind. Then he came and stood. Lord, you know I am not qualified to come before you. You know I'm a sinner. And I deserve to die for being a sinner. And I'm not here to claim right. But what exactly is my offense? Is this how you will watch these people destroy me? I brought you this little gift. Help the helpless. He that is father to the fatherless, help me. When the enemy is too strong for me, I will run to God. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? And then God looked at him, as unclean as this man is. He opened the Ghana must go. Say, what do you have there? Say, I just brought this little gift for you. He saw what was inside. Say, come. You have the mind to do this kind of thing. God pushed this man behind and now took over the battle and began to fight these people. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, imagine the confusion in the mind of these people, because I thought before we came to fight this man, we asked you, should we go into this battle against this man? How come you turned against us? Do you understand what I'm saying? We even brought sacrifice. But church, when it comes to spiritual things, there are levels. There are sacrifices and there are sacrifices. What this man did, in all fairness, we can't look at the small money offering you offered and allow you to continue to do what you want to do against him. Do you understand what I'm saying? He is heartbroken. He is devastated. But he is taking that step. Why? Because I need God to step into this battle for me. Brothers and sisters, people have different kinds of interpretations to these things, but it's not a transaction really like many of you interpret it. It is just a commitment and statement of conviction that look, I am desperate. I need to win this battle. I won't go down the way the enemy intends for me to go down. This is what this man is saying. And when God sees that conviction expressed in the kind of action he took, God says, no. I won't be a just God if I let this kind of thing happen. Because, ladies and gentlemen, whether what is happening to you is legitimate and should be happening or not, is not the issue. It is what you are willing to do in order to pull yourself out of that mess. Are you listening to me? Because it was the same God who said that it is wrong for you to deny a laborer his wages. How can this man be laboring and then you are the one eating the wage? He is starving. Himself and his country are starving. Do you understand what I'm saying at all? That's why he said, thou shalt not muzzle the ox that is treading corn. You don't understand what that means? Let me help you with understanding. Man of God, look. When he said, thou shalt not muzzle the ox when it is treading corn. See what was happening in Israel. You know the ox was not born an ox. You know what an ox is? It's a castrated bull. Hello? A castrated bull. They have removed the reproductive organs, the testes, castrated it so that it becomes unproductive biologically. Watch this. By doing that, the animal is starved of sex as well. So it's no longer dissipating energy on anything else. It now becomes stronger than the average male, the average bull that is not castrated. So the strength is increased for maximum impact. This animal goes out, they tie the plow during preparation, right? Where they are preparing the field for planting. They will tie the plow to this animal. And then with that enormous strength, as they dip the plow in the ground, they beat this animal. The animal begins to run. As it's running with that force, the ground is being cultivated. Do you understand? By the plow. After that, the harrowing. After the harrowing, church, imagine the strength this animal is dissipating. After doing all of that, then the planting, the animal goes through the same process. After the planting, the grass, the plants grow. As it grows and reaches harvest, during harvest season, they tie the harvester to this animal again. The animal begins to run through the field, harvesting the crops, the rice, the wheat, or whatever. After harvesting, they pack all this to the barn floor. When they get it to the barn floor, they now need to take the animal there to step on these sacks, on these things, in order to thresh it, to thresh the wheat. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Now they need his strength to do that. But now it is harvest time. They are threshing it on the threshing floor. Then they will go and create a bucket of skin, a bag, and put it on the mouth of the animal, tie it to his head, then send him to the threshing floor, so that while he is treading the corn, he will not be eating. Do you understand what I'm saying? You didn't get it. When it was
time to prepare the field. You didn't tie my mouth. When I was running through the field to plant the corn, you did not tie my mouth. When the thing reached harvest and we were harvesting, you didn't tie my mouth. Now it has reached threshing time when people should eat. You tie the mouth of the animal. God said that is wickedness that must not be practiced in Israel. Thou shalt not tie the mouth of the ox when it is treading the corn. Ladies and gentlemen, there are men and women listening to me here this morning whose mouths have been tied. They have labored and labored, but when it reaches the time when you should partake of the fruit of your own labor, the enemy comes with the muzzle. The enemy comes with the muzzle. He puts it on your mouth. I am here for somebody specifically. The Lord said to me to tell you that evil has got to stop. I came here with a mandate from heaven. That muzzle on your mouth will come off today. That muzzle around your life is about to come off today. That amen is not godly at all. Lift your voice. Let me hear your loudest amen. Papa said, I shall tell you that muzzle will come off your mouth. Lift your voice. Let me hear your loudest amen. Sit down. I want to close. Sit down. I want to close. That's the height of evil. I am working so hard. When we were laboring, you didn't tie my mouth. Now the time has come when I should enjoy the fruit of my labor, the muzzle, the mouth of the animal. This is what Moab was rebelling against and saying, no, we are tired of working and other people eating. We are growing lean, they are growing fat. Enough is enough. We've had enough of this affliction. And Moab understood that this is a battle of forces. This is a battle of the gods. This is a battle of the spiritual. And in order to conquer it, there's a sacrificial element of the spirituality that cannot be divorced from total independence and liberation. There is nobody who can break free from spiritual imprisonment, from spiritual captivity, without a sacrifice being offered. That's why man could not be redeemed without the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. Are you listening to what I'm saying? When it comes to redemption, when it comes to being liberated, when it comes to breaking free from the chains of oppression, somebody has got to do something very drastic. Look at the pain of those who watch their son and their hero dying on the cross. I feel the move of the Spirit of God right now. There's an evil going on under the sun. There are people who are working so hard, and yet the harder they work, the poorer they are getting. What do you think is going on? No labor is ever wasted. The only reason you think is wasted is you don't know who is eating the labor. But labor, you have been laboring, and the fruit is also coming. The harvest is also coming. The only problem is you have never been privileged to partake of the harvest of your own labor. After today's encounter, everything the enemy has stolen from you is about to be recovered. I say it's about to be recovered. I don't care who you are, what your shortcomings are. The devil has no place to oppress anybody. You are a servant of the Most High God. And the Bible says, who art thou, O man, that you should judge another man's servant? To his master he falls or rises. Are you listening to what I'm saying? Whoever is taking advantage of whatever is your human frailty and shortcoming, that agent of darkness is about to be subdued. If you believe it, shout a louder amen. If you believe it, Lord, it may come like thunder. I told people, the day I discovered this secret, I told myself, the devil has lost all power to oppress and afflict me, because I know the truth from the word of God. I was about losing a very valuable relationship. I didn't care what the enemy was suggesting and saying.
All I knew is that how can somebody who is of a huge benefit to me just suddenly turn their back on me like that? I didn't commit any offense. I didn't do anything wrong. I looked up, looked down, and said, God, you can't let this happen. You know you can't. I know you have many people you can use to be of a blessing to me. But this particular one is not going anywhere. I carried sacrifice, sir. Took it to my mentor. I laid it before me. I said, Daddy, I am about losing an important relationship. And I can't afford it. I can't afford it. He looked at me. Look at what I brought there. Jesus. He said, this thing must be very, really important. So let me pray for you. He said few words. I got off from that encounter. The same person who did not want to see me, who will not even pick my call again, called me by himself. He used his own hand. Called me, said, please send me, avail me of that your account details again. I want to sow a little seed. I sent it in less than 5 minutes. More than 6 zeros hit my account. Are you understanding what I'm saying? There is something about sacrifice that most church devotees have not understood yet. But I know for a fact, anytime you are about to put an end to nonsense in your family, the enemy will raise a battle. But the fight he raises, there is something that can arrest the battle for anyone, including the king of Moab, including an unrighteous king like the king of Moab, Mesha. There's something that can raise intervention for you. There's something that can raise intervention for you. Because in one church called Christ Lives Assembly in Port Harcourt on the New Street, I stepped in, finished speaking. I didn't speak more than 45 minutes. As I dropped the mic and made to leave, people rushed me. I said, no, why are you rushing me? Is that how they break protocol here? The pastor said, no, you bless them. And that's why they are rushing you. We don't restrict people from accessing, having access to our guests here. So please attend to them. I said, okay. I sat down, began to attend. The first person who walked up to me amongst the crowd that gathered was a lady from Enugu State, Amaka by name. The lady said to me, sir, the grace on your life is so potent. I need to make a sacrifice. But money I don't have. I need your God to intervene for me. I said, what Bible say? He said, sir, please let me just give you what I have. They said, in my entire life right now, at the moment, this is the most valuable thing in my life, this car that I drive. Here is the key. He said, the papers are in the pigeon hole. Pray for me, let your God intervene. I wouldn't just pray like that. I said, what do I ask God to do for you? What kind of intervention are you looking for? She said, I am only one thing. If God settles it for me, I'll be the happiest woman, even if he does not do any other thing for me. I said, no, he will do much more than what you are asking. He said, I'm owing two people 10 million. One 5 million, the other one 4.5 million. He said, please, sir, they are on my neck. I don't know what to do. As I borrowed the money, I was using it to do business. Everything filtered through my hands, finished. I don't know how the money finished. I don't have a dime. I almost couldn't fuel my car to come to church this evening. I said, what? Let's pray. As I started to pray, God said, no, what is making her lose money? It's not just something you will stand here and say in Jesus' name and this. He said, it's right there in your father's compound. Until you go and destroy that satanic monument, even if they contribute another 100 million and give to her, the money will finish the same way. The 10 million finish. Say, if you doubt me, ask her. She's not the only one suffering it. There are other siblings going through the same thing. When I said it, she broke down and started to cry. She said, how do you know, sir? My brother called me the other day and was complaining the same thing. I said, God knows you more than you can imagine. Brothers and sisters, when we were to go to her village to go and pray for family liberation, even the money to fuel my car, this lady could not afford it. I fueled my car from my pocket, drove with my team, we got into Enugu. If you know, are familiar with Enugu State, if you are coming from Okigwe, by the time you hit Teaching Hospital, after Teaching Hospital, that very popular junction they call Four Corner. If you veer off from Four Corner by the left, it will take you to that road that leads to Ninth Man. It will take you to former Governor Sleep and Chime's community. Now, immediately after Chime's village, the next community is where the lady comes from, Amaka by name. We finished that prayer at 12 midnight. God said, don't sleep here. Go into Enugu Township and Lord, let everybody leave the house. I didn't understand why. But we left Lodz. The following morning, I was driving back to Port Harcourt to preach for one Reverend Peter Joseph of CPM, Christian Pentecostal Mission, Rumodan. Brothers and sisters, my phone rang on our way. It was Amaka calling. He said, "Some we got into the compound. Now it was as if somebody ran a tractor in the compound. Ground broke, turned upside down. They entered the house. It's as if somebody entered and was shaking tables and turning things." When she was saying it, I was wondering. God said to me, "Son, tell them I have finished the battle in their absence. Tell them to go and prosper." I said it and ended the call. Brothers and sisters, a couple of days later, it was Amaka's call that woke me up from sleep. I took the call. She was jittery on the phone, shaking, a quiver in her voice. She was like, "Daddy, I don't know, but you need to pray for me. Their accountant are going 5.5 million. Just call me now. He's on his way to where I am." He had gone to her former house and met an empty house. She had packed her for fear of people she was going, but she didn't want the man to feel, she running away with his man. He said, "Sir, he said so early, this man should have been going to work instead of coming to look for me. Maybe he's coming with police. Please pray for me." I said, "Bless you." I said, "Come on, Amaka, shut up. You gave God your only car as a sacrifice, didn't you?" She said, "Yes, I did." I said, "And I prayed for you. Do you believe the grace on my life?" "Say, yes, I believe, sir. Pray, help me." I said, "Then relax, God is in control." I didn't even pray. Ended the call. A couple of hours later, Amaka was only to call me back. And the excitement was right. She was like, "Say, Sadu, you won't believe what happened. Look at what happened." A man came, sat down, asked her a couple of questions. How are things and all that and all that. After she complained and lamented how tough things were, he got up, said, "I need to get to work," and running late. As he turned the doorknob open, he closed it back, turned and looked at her. Said, "You know what? That money you are owing me, forget about it. You are no longer owing. 5.5 million. Just like that. That's not what touched me about this lady more. See, a man of God, there's how people touch God. He will intervene without thinking. I am telling you the truth. Do you know, a couple of weeks later, I was preparing to preach for a pastor in a Tuesday afternoon service. While I was dressing up to leave the house, my phone rang again. I took the phone. I said, "Amaka, can I be here for no collect this car from this guy that day?" Amaka, am I not going to do any other thing again? Reluctantly, I took the call. When I took the call, it was the excitement at the other end of the phone that brought life back to me. This lady was very excited. "Say, sir, you won't believe what I am about to tell you." Said, "Do you know, as I'm talking to you, I just finished signing a deal with the former SSG of Cross River State Government." He says, "Sir, the deal is worth 2.1 billion naira. Do you understand what I'm saying?" Let me tell you something. There's how people touch God. I don't care the battle. He will step in and you will see an intervention that you have never imagined before. Many people don't know how powerful God is until the day you touch him in an unusual manner. It was in a sacrifice of just 110,000. God was asking people to make sacrifices. A young guy was there wondering, should I not? God said, "Tell that young man, he should stop dilly-dallying. Step out. I want to intervene in that situation." He came out. How could I have known what was his problem? I didn't even know. But he made the sacrifice and even forgot about it. A couple of weeks later, secretary came and said, "There's a man here. He says he wants to see you." I said, "But I'm not here for counseling today. You know it. So why are you here?" So I told him, but he insists that he is not here for counseling. He just wants to share a little testimony with you. But when you hear testimony, you have to let the person in, because that's what made you even know whether there's somebody like me. The testimonies that accompany my ministry, you will not know I exist if not for the things that happen every time God speaks through me. So she came in, I could barely recognize him. But then he began to introduce himself and explain that he is the young man. I said, "God said he should challenge him with a little sacrifice of 110,000. I remember, because he had dreadlocks, but this time the dreads were no longer there. I asked, "What happened to the dreads?" "Say, change hairstyle." I said, "Okay, sorry." You know, all kinds of people come to church. What was his challenge? He had a growth in his testes. Very massive growth. Sir, the growth was massive. Not the one that is water or air that filled the scrotal sac. This one was a mass. Even doctors were wondering, what kind of growth is this and where is it coming from? They wanted to do a surgery on him. They were afraid because that kind of surgery could lead to complications and he won't be able to father children. So they were referring him to Germany or India, where it could be handled with a higher degree of sophistication with minimal damages. Brothers and sisters, do you know that was the point he when he laid that sacrifice on the altar, that the severe pain he used to feel in that place stopped. When the pain stopped, he decided to watch himself for a while. He thought it was a joke. In the weeks that followed, the thing had begun to shrink and reduce in size. In up to 4 weeks after, the thing had returned to its normal size. He said, no, I need to be sure I am not dreaming. He went to hospital. Doctors were asking him, when did you go for surgery without a referral? He said, I didn't go for any surgery. God operated on me. They checked him through and through. The growth had disappeared by the power of sacrifice. Let me be honest with you, church. Some of us may never fit in as your pastors. Like me now, I am not wired to be your pastor. Look at Reverend Adekoya. He is the one qualified. God prepared him specially to be able to pastor you. I can't be a pastor to you, but I am a messenger of God to carry out a specific assignment. Are you listening to me? There are men you meet, the story of your life can never be told the same way.
Let me close with my own testimony. How did it happen? So many things I can't even begin to say. But I had heartbreak until I got tired of relationships. I said, no, I can't deal anymore. It took God's intervention for me to muster the courage to go out again and meet someone, say, I want to marry. When I got this lady, oh my God, I've never been loved that way before. I was so loved, I couldn't handle it. I said, why waste for that time? We enrolled for the marriage counseling sessions. Then in the course of the counseling sessions, we got to the final point where we'll pick our wedding day. We filled forms, signed, ran tests, and brought results. The marriage committee chairman looked at my form, looked at her own, looked through, checked, shook his head, and when he adjusted his glasses, he looked up, he said, Pastor Amos, you know what? We won't be able to go ahead with this wedding because you are AS genotype. Your fiancé here is AS genotype. Brothers and sisters, I had already gotten tired of heartbreak and disappointment. I left that meeting crying profusely like a baby. I was telling God, please, not again. I can't go through this another time. Please show me mercy. I can't deal. While I was crying, my pillow soaked in tears. God said to me, son, something can still be done about this. I said, are you sure about that? God repeated it. I cleaned my eyes, took my phone, called my friend, said, baby, we're going ahead with this wedding. She said, are you out of your mind? You know what you are talking about. Ladies and gentlemen, I didn't need a lecture from anyone. One of the courses I took in the course of my university education was animal breeding and genetics. If anybody should understand the implications of marrying AS and AS and the possibility of giving birth to C-class, I should know better. I mean, but now I have heard God, and boy, you don't want to watch a C-class have crisis. Oh my God, you will wish the person rather die than go through that kind of torture. You won't even wish it for your enemy, let alone your child. I said to her, angel, you know what, baby girl, you know what? God said that we told me that we won't have given birth to C-class. She said, are you sure about that? I said, God said. She said, if God said, then I go with you. The following day, we wrote a letter to marriage committee, indicated that we appreciate the work we are doing for God, wanted to be on record that they stopped us from having this wedding. We went ahead against their advice. I signed, she signed. Ladies and gentlemen, look, this is one of the reasons, if anybody believes on this earth that God called me, is the woman I married. When we split our wedding date and we are going ahead to have our wedding, everyone who knew about this was afraid for us except me. We got married, it took us 3 years. We're not even thinking about children. We're just saying, God, please don't let us see shame. We were sacrificing dangerously. God will say, give me this, we'll give it. Give me that, we'll give it. We sacrificed us. The one particular, we were preparing for a particular family project. The first 100,000 came. My wife looked at me, looked at the man, and said, angel, you know what? No, my wife calls me angel. Secretly. Because the way women don't reject fire. I'm that woman, they call her an angel. Is God not wonderful? She said to me, every time you give money, God said, so that God will not say on top of this 100,000, you are not going to keep it. I will keep this one. She took the 100,000, went and kept it in her savings account in Zenith Bank. Now, God, fear God. People, fear God. God left me this time around and went to her. That 100,000 in the back, I want it. In the middle of the service like this, my wife was vibrating. I already knew what was happening to her. I said, go ahead. Do as he is commanding you. Don't harden your heart. Go ahead. He will answer. So
She used her own two legs, went to bank, pulled out that 100,000. We took it to the altar, man of God, and laid it before God. That was a strong approach. After, right there at the altar, God said to me, son, it's time. We got off from that encounter. My wife missed her period. I had been away preaching somewhere for a couple of days. When I got back to Port Harcourt, she was still at work. I had not seen her. Then, oh my God, I said, let me just see a pastor friend that we have not seen for a while, a more senior colleague. When I got to his house, the man had drawn a long list of names of people and phone numbers, was calling them and asking for money to buy himself a car, to put together and buy himself a car because he was still trekking. As I heard this man make those calls, God said to me, son, this is your time, your chance. If you miss it, I don't know when else you'll catch it. I said, God, what are you talking about? Say, how will it be said that a man of God of your caliber, say God told him to marry a woman, AS genotype like him, and you are giving back to sick life? I want to remove that reproach from your life permanently. Say, cry, God. How, so what are you saying? I know when God begins to talk like that. He said, that money you came back with, I want you to go and pass you all of it. Don't take anything out of it. Come and give it to this, my servant. Let him add it to what he has and buy himself a good car to drive and do my work with ease. And I will remove that reproach from your life. Church, this was the hardest thing God will ever ask me to do. Because as at that time, in Genesis, I'm still used to that kind of honorarium. It wasn't very familiar, very regular. A very small congregation, up to like this row here. That's their size. Small but mighty. They said, we hear you a fine preacher. We want to enjoy good preaching. Don't talk about money, just bless us. We are prepared for you. I finished preaching, sir, after 3 days. My church pursued honorarium, 600,000 naira cash. And then another money, they said, people who said you bless them individually, they brought it. They passed it. When I got back to my hotel room, I counted 726,000 naira cash. As at that time, honorarium of 700,000 wasn't very regular in my life, once in a while. Not now, sha, but because now, sincerely, like every other week, that one is changed. But this was a big deal for me. I got back to Port Harcourt. I was very excited, in high spirit. Then God said, don't take 1 naira out of it. Give it to this, my servant. I went back home, eh? I excused myself, went back home, carried that money. I was walking back to my car like a zombie. Drove to this man's house, brought out that parcel, said, sir, God said I should give you this. Add it to what you have and buy a car. I walked out feeling like, you know this kind of sacrifice you make, and you walk out feeling like they don't brainwash you. They don't do you. That was how I felt. I walked out of that place. But brothers and sisters, while I was feeling terrible, the pain in my heart over the sacrifice I just made, a few days later, I took my wife to the lab just to confirm whether she was actually pregnant or not. It was a menstrual cycle disorder. The person that drew her blood sample in the lab ticked on the form, they ticked on the form pregnancy test, then went ahead and ticked genotype as well. I said, no, that's not why I brought my wife here. Didn't bring my wife for you to check her genotype, just to confirm whether she's pregnant or not. So, well, I just feel like doing it for you. It's free of charge anyway. Don't worry. I'm not going to charge you for it. So, doctor said, now, which kind of wahala is this? I obliged her. Do you know, sir, when they ran the test and the result came out eventually, not only was my wife pregnant, but God had also changed her genotype from AS to AA by the power of sacrifice. Ladies and gentlemen, when some of us talk about the power of sacrifice, we are not talking heresy. We are not saying what they say then say. I am talking what we have personally experienced. Are you listening to what I am saying? I have seen the effectiveness of fasting and prayers, but I've also seen the uselessness of fasting and prayer without sacrifice. I don't care where you are stuck right now, whether you come out of it alive or die in the midst of that affliction, as if there's no God, will be determined by what you do with this woman. Stand to your feet and lead us to pray. It was just towards the end of last year, pursuing on my own, God said to me, son,